Hello and welcome to Music Coding for Everyone. My name is Samuel Wright and I'm a music and Apple Distinguished Educator from Vienna, Austria. I work at a school called Amadeus and I am the secondary music teacher there. We're going to look at coding and music together. So to start, let's go to a performance game called Complementary Rhythms. This is where students and teachers gathered in the Netherlands for a composition or improvisation workshop. Each student had to make up their own pattern that they then looped. The aim of this game is to find patterns that work with each other so that we can make our own performance. This is where Music Coding for Everyone comes into play. We're going to be looking at three key areas: the music, playing it, and coding it. And we'll actually try to incorporate some performance and creative activities the whole way through. But first we need some coding terms. We have bugs, we have commands, we have composition, we have functions, loops, nest, pattern, and variables. All of these are brought to you from the Swift Playgrounds, the free coding application on iOS. What I'd like you to do is to take particular notice of the function, the nest, pattern, and variable. These are all throughout music, and we'll address them constantly as we go through this video. So let's move on to just a part of the lesson of why we're focusing on this and how I see music and coding working together. We have a quote here from the 7th century. Unless sounds are remembered by man, they perish, for they cannot be written down. Now that is a problem. A little bit later, Guido Arezzo, the invention of the musical score as we know it today, is attributed to Guido, born in 991. From then till now, the traditional score has evolved into a highly sophisticated language for encoding musical expression with various idiosyncrasies or personal styles. That's a key feature because our students have their own personal styles. But we still need to write it down. So let's start with Bach. Bach himself encoded his name into a piece called the Art of Fugue, BWV 1080, by using the German equivalent of B is B flat, A, C, and B natural for H. I recommend you watch it here on YouTube with this link. Many composers followed in this trend: Liszt, Schoenberg, and of course Schumann. Schumann loved veiled allusions, symbolism, and mystery, and his musical thinking is no less fantastic or subtle. For example, he worked his wife's name into compositions by way of a cipher. Her name, Clara, is worked out from the first measure on the left, where we have a row for the naturals, a row for the flats, and a row for the sharps. Shostakovich also encoded his name into a cryptogram, worked out as DSCH, D, E flat, C, B in the German system again. His string quartet number 8 is both a fantastic use of this cipher and the development of its musical material. Haydn, he had the clever idea of a palindrome, the same pattern forwards as backwards, for the entire structure of his minuet in the 47th symphony. This is a very clever use of a number pattern as an overall architecture for writing music. On the top, we've got the minuet. For the first system, the top half is forwards, and then the second system, the bottom half, is the same as the top, just backwards. Now we're at Ravel. Now this is very clever, I want to show you. He took the name of Haydn and encoded it into a piano piece, but listen carefully to what he does. Here we have the Haydn motif or code recalled in the top melody part. And Ravel uses it as a structure for building the other parts around to create this beautiful piece of music. He will also start to turn it upside down, play it backwards, put it in the bass, invert it, all sorts of tricks or techniques to encode the name of Haydn within this piece. Let's try a different type of music now. Let's go to Taylor Swift and how we can code her music inside GarageBand. And here is where you can see my students are taking the exact same blocks to loop and create their own structures. This then culminates in an off-schoolwork classroom performance of Seven Nation Army by the White Stripes. Again, you should be able to see the nested blocks of notes repeating in looped functions. The point of all this is that music encodes multiple commands and functions within a loop structure of variables all the time, even with complicated pieces such as Ideal of Hope from the Man of Steel film. We can take complicated notated structures such as man, a kryptonite man, a kryptonite strong man, strong man, a strong man, and it makes it easier for us to perform and play as well as in the classroom with our students. All we have to do is break it down into simpler terms or structures. Again, if we were to take another Hans Zimmer piece, like the piece Interstellar, have a listen to the many layers or complementary layers that are playing within this piece and how they work together. Again, and I'm going to teach you a little about music and coding. Now, coding doesn't have to be a string of numbers, it can also be patterns. And what better way to learn and make music? So I have here some colored bells, C to C in a C major scale. We can refer to them as notes or we can refer to them as colors. What we're going to do is put them into a pattern. For example, or and we can build our piece of music that way. What I have done is brought a little box along, and this is a way we can program music just using patterns. So for example, there's a band called OK Go, and they've provided their samples into this tiny little box. What I can do is play their samples and record them just like the bells here. Put that, my programmed piece of music, together with this. And I've written a piece of music straight away just using repetition or sequences of pattern. One of the reasons I'm laboring this point and giving many examples is because music and coding are linked. There is no other way to see this more visibly than with music technology. You can see the programming happening live in front of you. Here we are putting in the beats, the heartbeat pattern from Stranger Things. Using a Korg Volca machine, I can program a beat. This time in groups of four. Now, if I was to then take a bass instrument and use something as simple as an arpeggio, I can code the arpeggio C major 7 chord from Stranger Things. And now we've made it. We're at the application stage of coding music in Minecraft. Do you remember those coding terms? We're going to put them into practice by building inside of Minecraft. Now, Minecraft uses blocks, so we're going to make squares for our loops, and we're going to encode a loop of Bad by Michael Jackson. Take particular note of the redstone, the red lines, which is like a musical circuit which carries energy around the loop. This world has been published to Minecraft EDU, and you can download it and the lesson for free online at Minecraft EDU. As you have seen by now, I take models and present those to my students when I recreate or code something with a program. Here is no exception. We are going to use Steve Reich's clapping music. We start in binary, 1 is a beat, 0 is a rest, and we can use the make code or code connector in Minecraft EDU to have our little bot create the square loops for us. As you can see right here on the screen, I type in a command, make sure I spell it correctly, and a little robot builds the square loop for me. Now I have to make sure I use the right dimensions and I have all of my beats and my rests counted and prepared beforehand. Then using something called note blocks, and again, I have to make sure I count the rests and the beats carefully, I place them around the square loop and connect them with something called redstone, which is again, like a musical or Minecraft circuit. That's just a linear version of the first pattern from clapping music. But if we go over to the looped version over here, you can see the redstone all around the loop. Those little gray squares are called repeaters. Now, if I press this button here, the loop will play. Oh no, it's stuck. What do we call that? Debugging. I just call it problem solving. We started all the way at the beginning with just improvising complementary rhythms. Throughout every example, we have seen that there are patterns and loops that are played over the top of each other. Even with Minecraft, we saw that we can encode loops and patterns for model pieces of music. Here we have Sonic Pi, made for both Mac and PC, and it is going to play the entire piece of music called Clapping Music by Steve Reich using Ruby language. I found this code at the Miskatonic University Press website. It goes through a whole lesson on clapping music from YouTube, showing the shifting patterns, and then you can copy and paste the exact code into your own Sonic Pi program to work out how to do it yourself. It was that easy. Anyone can use Sonic Pi, and I highly recommend it. Let's move away from rhythm and go to pitch now. Let's listen to some works, two in fact, by Philip Glass. I hope you enjoyed those two pieces. We are now going to use Sonic Pi to encode the music from both of those pieces. I've simplified it. All I'm going to be looking at is the chordal or arpeggio patterns. So the first thing we're going to do here for etude number one is we need to know what the notes are for the chords and write them out vertically. Because they're triplets, we've got that written there. And we also need to say we want them to be played four times. You'll get the hang of this the more you experiment with it. Once again, it's a free download. At the very end, I've also got bass notes that I want to be emphasized with each chord change. I have to use the sleep function within the triplets to tell the computer to do this. Let's listen to it. The second piece we'll be encoding is Philip Glass's Going to Make a Cake. It's an appropriate layer metaphor, don't you think? This one uses a rotating minor third in C and A3, which are pitch references on the keyboard for octaves. And instead of a loop, I've counted the repetitions I would need and told it to play 32 dot times. I then added some longer notes so that I could have the octaves on top in the right hand. I hope you've enjoyed this video. Thank you for participating. We've gone through so much from Bach all the way through to Philip Glass. There's much to watch on YouTube. There's much to download and coding to try. Have a go, experiment, give it to your students, and who knows, you may have the next Philip Glass, but for coding in your classroom. Thank you very much.